please.
Hello. I would like to ask you, what is the impact of the war on cat cultivation in Yemen? Has it become less? Are people chewing more? Are they chewing less?
The cat is still there. Yeah. But the problem is now with the income. The people have not enough income to buy the cat. There is no water to irrigate the cat, and there is no enough income to buy the cat. So the problem from different sides.
So, but does that mean that production went down of
cats? Yes, yes, yeah. And it's getting expensive because of the pumping groundwater. Yeah, it's not as before. Yeah.
Yes, please, if you have no question. Yes, please, here. There. Yeah.
شكرا لك كثير على هذا التقديم الرائع بس
just
كنت حاب
استفسر wait a minute just to allow translation if you
ready
yes
go شكرا ahead, لك على هذا التقديم الرائع بس كنت حاب استفسر this solar system is on a grid system or off grid يعني this battery
no.
or sharing to network or to
no no
to
it
grid.
Is off grid it is private systems.
All this is private.
Yes, private. Everyone has to buy his own system and connect his own system.
The grid متوفر ولا لا?
No, no. There is no public grid for solar systems. But even in the public sector, they start even to use solar energy to pump groundwater. Also, they start to install some solar systems for pumps itself. The people start to think about such renewable resources and it is important. Of course, the war is bad things, but it is kind of awareness about such systems in such terrible situations.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yes, a last question. The lady over there.
Hello, good afternoon. Thank you very much for the presentation. One question, as we now see this shift from public services, because there are no public services, to private services. Which recommendations do you have to prepare for such situations? As, I mean, the region is highly fragile and there is political unrest expected in many other countries also. How to prepare for such situations? Like, what are mitigation measures?
I think the governments themselves should start to consider such systems and encourage people to look after such systems. And yeah, it is, I mean, not only during the wars, but it is renewable things. It is even during the base. I think we have to start to think about the systems even during the base periods. Yeah. So I don't know if I answered your questions correctly or not. Sorry?
For water sector themselves.
Yeah.
What is
I'm more mitigation? Interested in the water sector than the energy.
Yeah, as I said before, even now in the water sector, the public utilities start to use solar energy instead of generators for pumps to pump groundwater. And it helps not only for public utilities, but also the farmers themselves start to aware about this source and its importance. So yeah, there more awareness is needed, especially from the government sides, and yeah, from international agencies to encourage people to use these things. Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Musad. So I have to, because we have limited time, to the speaker number two that talks about the impact of Syrian refugees in the local and cross-border water economy in the Jordan River Basin. I would like to invite Mr. Pin. Mr. Pin, has actually a long experience. He's a senior researcher at the Center of World Food Study, and he's an ex-FAO, and he's also has an expert in research in the modeling of relation between land equality and agricultural production and eco-services. So, Mr. Musad, you have floor. Please go ahead. You have 15 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for the introduction. Is this working?
You have, please touch the microphone.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for this introduction. I'm going to talk about and the local and cross-border impact of Syrian refugees in the Jordan River Basin, and especially the effects on the water economy. It has been a special request of our Jordanian counterparts, two of them who are also co-author of this publication, Professor Hani Abu Qadais and Professor Fayez Abdullah, both affiliated to the Jordan University of Science and Technology in Irbid. What we are going to discuss is, first we take a basin-wide view and we see if there are any cross-border effects, and not only at nationwide but also at the districts. So if certain accumulations of refugees, if they have an impact locally or across the border. Then after that we will zoom in and we go more to a policy practice, and we take a special look at the Za'atari camp and what kind of options are there to improve the livelihood of the refugees. And after that we wrap up. This study was done in the framework of the Concerted Sharing Project. We gave already several presentations about this project. It is a project that has developed a water economy model for the Jordan River Basin. And I will explain in the very brief terms about the practicalities of this model. You see here our counterparts, which all represent the riparian states, except for one, which is Israel, for obvious reasons of participation. The outline I just explained, we first take a basin-wide view, then we go to the local level and see what we can do on broadening a view from water to food security as one of the policy options to improve the welfare of the refugees. If we take a basin-wide view, we have actually two countries that are a hub for the refugees. One is Lebanon. And if you cover then the basin part, then you only have the southern, southeastern part that is part of the basin, and there about 22,000 refugees reside. So much more than in Jordan. You can see also in the picture where the concentrations of refugees are now, where you can find them. And here we find within the basin about 423,000 registered refugees. The informal accounts are much larger, but we follow here the UNHCR statistics. So what we use to get this basin-wide view is the water economy model that we developed in the last 3.5 years, and which is now operational to address several policy questions. as it said there, it's a decision support tool to measure local and cross-boundary effects of water policy interventions. We have 48 districts, 2 weekly time steps. We make balances over 5 layers, and we have 3 pollutants representing the biological oxygen demand, salinity, and nitrate concentrations. So the model is characterized by the interconnectedness between all those dimensions that are there. It also represents the quality of water, and we are able to link the water to different economic activities, one of them being the food production and another one household use. That was just a brief summary of the model. In other presentations, we gave a more extended overview. Now, for this model, we designed a scenario and we said the per capita water demand of the refugees is the same as for the local population, which we think is a reasonable assumption. And the additional demand that is needed for the refugees is met by an increased groundwater pumping and partly by reducing irrigation activities. If we take then a look at what is happening basin-wide, we clearly can see that there are two regions that are actually affected in the magnitude of and proportional, I could better say, to the amount of refugees that are hosted there. In Jordan, we get a consumptive demand for water extra on top of what is currently being used of 14 million cubic meter. You can see that as well, that for the availability of water for irrigation, you will lose water because it has to be, you have to transport it to the refugees. And then, of course, positively, wastewater that is available for reuse, that also increases because the water has nice characteristic. It hardly leaves the system except for the evapotranspiration. So you can reuse it as well. In the graph, you can see the groundwater stock changes, and those actually prevail basically in Jordan and somewhat to a lesser extent in Jordan. if we take a look at the district level, because our model also allows to do that, then you can see that if we take a look here, and actually I forgot to put an on the x-axis, it's a relative change in agricultural production. Now, and you can see actually that there are minimal effects, especially in districts where hardly any refugees are hosted. So we can say that basin-wide, the impact is rather local than cross-border effects. So if that, I should, how do I get back? That is page down. Ah, yeah. Year previous. I should go back.
Back to the previous slide.
Yeah.
From this arrow. These are the arrows are okay.
Okay, one more.
One more.
Yeah. One. No, no. It should go up.
Up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, back. Backwards. Back. It should go back.
These are the arrows.
The previous one. Yeah.
You.
No. No. Further. Further. No, you're going forward. We have to go backward.
Okay,
thank you very much. Very good. Okay, thanks. Sorry for this interruption. So we took a basin-wide look, and what we concluded is that there are hardly any cross-border effects. So from the policy's perspective, it allows you then to zoom in on your own district, to do any interventions. And we do that as an example for the Zaatari camp. Most likely you heard of it. It's the biggest refugee camp in Jordan, hosting at the moment some 60 to 70,000 refugees. I visited the Lord Mayor of Zaatari because it's a small village itself, 20,000 people are there. And I said, hey, that's nice. My village is also about 20,000 persons. And I said, and we have 600 refugees. And he said, oh, that's nice. Yeah, we have also 20,000 inhabitants, but I have 60,000 refugees. Just to get the order of magnitude right. Now, the camp itself, you can see it from the graph there, as an compared to the usual situation, an enormous pressure on the water resources and in the amount of water that has to be transported to the camp. And what we will do here, you can see how the camp grew from 20 to 100,000 inhabitants. It fluctuates over the last few years, and now there are about 60,000 persons. So what is well described in a lot of studies is the water supply and how it is actually getting to the people, and knowing we know how much liter per person per day. But about the food supply is actually hardly anything known, and there are hardly any studies. And what we wanted to do here, also on the request of our partners, is to see what is the possibility for allotment gardens. that could indeed reduce the pressure on local food systems. But you can imagine that also they need to be fed as well, and so allotment gardens could be a possibility. There is also, of course, potential, as we just noticed. There is quite some wastewater that can be reused. And currently, some almost 2 million cubic meter per year is being available. And if you divide it by the drip irrigation that is needed per year, you get about 340 hectare that can be used for cultivation. Now, what did we do? We made a cost-benefit analysis to see if that is economically a feasible option. And we took into account the collection methods, the construction of a sewer system, and the irrigation cost that needed to be calculated for. Now, if we then, under the current collection methods, take a look what is possible, then we can see, and here maybe I should explain first, in the first column you see the net revenues that will be gained by producing per hectare the the food in those allotment gardens, and they vary from 2,000 to 4,000, which I think are modest estimates. You find the discount rates 3 to 7% for different scenarios of repaying the investments, and those investments are paying for operation and maintenance, for additionally for construction, and then additionally also for collection. Now the figures in red you can see are negative, and in that case economically it's not feasible, but there are also positive signs that if the figures are black, you can see that it's positive. And in this case, we do hypothetically a kind of private investment scenario for which there is no public support. But if you usually, if we talk about sewer systems and collecting sewer, that is most of the time covered by the government. And in that case, I will not go into that scenario, but in that case, there can be a win-win situation when those public interventions and those public investments are really being made. Then you can see that it's economically feasible. So the story I told is what we can conclude. There is a substantial impact of those large refugee camps, local water demand, wastewater production. But there are also opportunities. There is a reuse of wastewater food production, and that really can result in a win-win situation. Allotment gardens, we saw, are economically feasible, especially when the public investments are being made. And as such, we have now broadened the scope from water to food security, which is indeed addressing the needs and the urgent needs of those the refugees, as well as releasing the pressure on local communities. Mr. Chairman, that was my presentation.
Thank you for this. So I will allow 5 minutes for question. I will start from the gentleman here, please.
Actually, it is not a question, it is a comment. Mr. Ben, you are welcome in Jordan.
Thank you.
But actually, we are disappointed to see Israel, what you call it, Israel, in a comparison sheet with Arab countries. Okay, thank you very much.
May I just make a brief comment on this remark?
Yes, sure.
To avoid any confusion, we didn't have any partnership with Israel on specific request of our partners from Lebanon and Syria, because then they could not participate in the project. So Israel is not part of this project. We have all riparian states except for what I said, Israel, for obvious reasons. So in that sense, I cannot place your remark, but I hope I cleared the way, and in that there is no participation of Israel. Okay.
Sure, it means used for comparison purposes only. Yes, another question? over there, and the gentleman ahead.
Thank you. Ben, it's an interesting observation that you can generate food with the wastewater, but there are cultural issues, as you well know, and in Jordan and elsewhere. So have you assessed the feasibility of that, you know, in the actual cultural circumstances in which you find yourself here?
Yeah. Thanks for this question. It's an interesting remark. One of my PhD students, Amani Al-Farah, she did her study on the willingness to pay for wastewater use in irrigation areas in the Jordan Valley. And actually what came out of is that farmers are very willing to pay for it.